So let's begin. Hello, everyone. Welcome to one of our most sought after workshops, the Snake Workshop. In today's session, we will explore the identification and behavior of snakes, bust some myths, and most importantly, learn what one can do when they encounter snakes. We request all the participants to hold on to any questions that you may have till the end of the session, and we will ensure to answer them all. Let me now quickly introduce you to our presenters. Colonel Dr. Nawaz Sharif has served 33 years of decorated service in the Indian Army. He was also actively deployed with the Indian Peacekeeping Force in Sri Lanka. He has commanded many Army canine units actively deployed in demining explosive detections and terrorist apprehension operations. He was selected as the first Deputy Inspector General of Police in the Indo-Tibetan Border Police Force, where they were responsible for guarding the 3,600 kilometer long Indochina border. Presently, he is the chief veterinarian and general manager at PFA Wildlife Rescue and Conservation Center, Bangalore. Our second presenter for the day is Mr. Karthik Prabhu. Karthik is a zoologist and a wildlife conservationist who has worked extensively in creating awareness about wildlife and environment. He has educated over 2.5 lakh people across South India. He is presently pursuing his PhD in wildlife management and works as a wildlife curator at our hospital. With an in-depth understanding of wildlife rescue and rehabilitation, Karthik has successfully implemented several unique rehab techniques that aid in the successful recovery of animals. Over to Colonel Nawaz and Karthik.
Hello, good morning to you all. I'm Colonel Nawaz. Welcome you and let me start the presentation. So slithering with snakes, we'll be talking about identification, behavior, and telling you, busting some myths about them. So what are snakes? So as you all know, snakes are reptiles. They are vertebrate animals with dry, it's a general description, dry scaly skin. And they typically lay soft shelled eggs. So there are over 3,000 snake species identified all over the world, venomous and non-venomous, and more so are being discovered every day. And they are worshipped for many reasons in many countries all over the world. So like I said, about in India, there are about 238 species of snakes are found, and many are being added as and when discovery is taking place. The reticulated python is the longest snake in the Indian subcontinent. It's almost, they say it measures around 33 feet and found in the northeast. The rock python, which is very common all over the country, measures around 12 to 15 feet. And the king cobra, which is found mostly in the Western Ghats, so is the longest, the venomous snake. So there is one interesting thing about the king cobras. It is the world's only limbless reptiles which builds a nest for laying eggs. It is not done by anybody. Now, what are the role of snakes in nature? And how does it help the ecology? So this is very important. So they are the nature's best natural pest controllers. They are the farmer's friend. So they play a huge role in preventing damage to the food crops. So if you take a rodent burrow in a farmer's field, if you dig out, you'll find more than 1 kg of food grain or seeds in that burrow, which the rodents take them into the burrow. And who gets them? Who controls this? Who maintains the ecological balance? Who acts as a natural predator of rodents?
Snakes. So
these are the snakes. So snakes eat around 3 to 5 meals per week. So if you take the rodents, they almost eat around 300 rats per year. Now, snakes are the only one which can go deep into a burrow and eat all the rodents, either they are adults or young ones. And you know how the rodents reproduce? They reproduce exponentially in the absence of predators. So the gestation period for rodents is around 21 to 23 days. And the female has 4 litters per year. And each litter has around 3 to 6 young ones. So imagine, so how the population will explode. And each of the young ones become mature again at 10 weeks. So just imagine the population, what a havoc they will cause. Not only that, so what the farmer does in the field to prevent the pest, he keeps pumping all these pesticides to kill all the more toxic and toxic, but it doesn't affect these rodents at all. How come? So they go into the burrows, they stay inside. So all this pesticide remains on the ground level. And who can go get this guys? Only the snake. So what happens to all this toxic pesticide the farmer is pumping? It doesn't affect the rodents at all. So it goes as ground or soil residue, and then it comes back to you and me and everybody as an unseen enemy. Toxics in the fruits, the vegetables, we don't know what is the percentage, PPM, we don't know. So we all eating all this. So it has been proven by scientists that the basic reason of increase of phenomenal number of cancer is directly related to this. And they also play a very important role in controlling zoonosis. Now, what is zoonosis? The zoonosis is the transmission of disease from animal to human beings. So the rodents almost spread around 35 diseases in the world. The most important being leptospirosis, you all must be knowing, salmonellosis, tularemia, the hantavirus virus, the plague. So these are some of them. And how do you get them? By either directly coming in contact with the rodents, their feces or urine. So when the rodents gets affected by these diseases or they are in incubation period, they become a bit slow. They're not so agile as the other rodents. So snakes first go get them. They eat them up. So what are they doing? So they're preventing the chain. So they play a major role. The snakes also play a major role in prevention of these zoonotic diseases. So they're killing the transmission. Yes, Neha.
Thank you so much, sir. Okay, friends, let's see the snakes, what are available in the Bangalore. So first, let's see non-venomous species. So you can see this slide, Indian rock python. This is the one of the very, very largest snakes found in Bangalore. So this can grow up to 12 to 15 feet. And especially seeing that diet, so the most of the pythons, they do consume the bigger prey, like even sometimes in a captive dogs, like a black naped hares, even jungle, they have a possible of hunting the even deers as well. And breeding behavior of the pythons, they do lay eggs. They have a capacity to lay around 60 to 80 eggs. And this is the one of the common species which incubate their eggs and hatch it. Till the hatching, the mother will stay in the egg. Next egg. And other common snake, Indian rat snake. So Indian rat snake, one of the longest non-venomous species found in Bangalore. So this will come into different colors. When you see the photo, this rat snake, yellow in color. Also, you can see the rat snake, little darkish olive green color as well. So most of the rat snakes look similar to the cobra. So people do misunderstand cobras and rat snake. And the rat snakes are good climbers, very fast moving snakes, and they are also good swimmer as well. And they do stay under the leaf litters and a burrows. Next. So these are the two sand boas where we found in the Bangalore. First photos, common sand boa, which looks exactly similar to the Indian rock pythons. So people do confuse. See, when you're seeing a couple of species, whether non-venomous and venomous snakes, the most of the snakes looks very, very similar. Like a Indian rock python, common sand boa, and Russell's viper as well. So when you're seeing the snakes, you should be very, very aware of how it looks, and observing appearance is very important. Yeah. So when we're talking about sand, common sand boa, they have a huge prey options. Like they do consume small rodents, small lizards, small birds as well. And they do found commonly in muddy areas, sand areas, pile of stones, rocks, such places. And they
you can also tell them about the myths about sand boa.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. So if when it's seeing about the breeding things, sand boas do give a birth up to like a 3 to 6 young ones. And second photos, red sand boa. So red sand boa is one of the very, very common and very threatened species as well. Hope you guys aware of that. People do try and sail the red sand boa, and they have a lot of myth as well. So when you see this particular photo, you can see one end is a head and second end is a tail. But people have a myth says 6 months snakes move forward and another 6 months snakes move backwards. That's not a right. So sand boa have a single head, other part is a tail, and they have a characteristics to mimic as a head when the predator or any threatening is happening. So this species will coil the body and keep the snake head under inside the body and keep the tail up. So when the attack is happening, so the thought head is in that, they consider they'll thought head is a tail. So they will attack by mistake, and it's the escape chance of the snake. And bronzeback tree snake. So bronzeback tree snake, one of the very, very fast snakes, and this is arboreal snakes. They do found on the cannabis trees, and they're very long. They can grow up to like a 5 to 6 feet long, very slender body, very lean. And they are one of the beautiful snake as well. You can see bronzeback snake, like a bluish color patches on the neck as well. And there is a very common myth about this particular snakes. So in people do say, like a village people do say, is this particular species snakes bite, the people die, and the snakes follow the victim till they die, and also follow the dead body till the burial ground. Actually not. So bronzeback tree snake is a completely non-venomous species, and they have a capacity of laying around 2 to 6 eggs. Next.
Sir.
Yes, hi. Yeah.
Like this snake, this kind of the snake, it looked like the snake once, like when I was gone to my school trip, like one naturalist person had put this on my hand and all.
Okay.
And hey, we can take questions in the end, please.
Amog, yeah, hi. So a request to all participants, we will open the session for interaction and questions in the end. Yeah. So we request you to kindly hold on to all of your questions and comments till the end. So we finish the presentation first. Yeah. Thank you so much. Karthik, yes.
Yeah, next slide, Snake. Vein snake. Again, this is a similar character to the bronze snake snake, and the vein snake also arboreal snakes. They're very fast moving snake as well. And again, myths about this particular species of a snake, the people say the snake, vein snake do attack the human eyes. Actually, that is a myth. So for any movement, fast movement, that will attract the snakes. So due to the snakes are arboreal, they always found in a little higher than a ground level. So sometimes by mistake, it might be happen, but it's not. So vein snake is won't attack particularly the eyes. And easy identification of this particular species, slender body, very long, up to 6 feet they can grow, and completely green in color. When they feel like a threatening, they will enlarge the scale near the neck part, and they will make it bigger. So during that time, you can able to see black and white scale alternatively, and they give a birth around like a 6 to 8 babies. Yeah. So again, one of our common and beautiful snakes, common trinket. So the common trinket have a very, very unique character than other snakes. So every other snakes have a defense mechanism. And especially with the common trinket, when they feel threatened, when they feel something going to happen, the defense mechanism is so beautiful. If you see the first photo, the snake, the head completely bended like a S shape, and the mouth was little open. You can see the darkness inside. So this is a very common and very unique behavior with this common trinket snake. And they do lay eggs. So common trinkets are lay eggs around 8 to 12. And this is one of the non-venomous species. Yeah. So let's talk about kukri snakes. So commonly, these are two kukris, very, very common, found around the Bangalore. If you see first photograph, it's a banded kukri, and second photograph, Russell's kukri. So people do misunderstand banded kukri and common kite. So because of banded kukri have a band on the body, they do consider this is a kite, and they mistake and they also killing it. But kukris are non-venomous species. They're not harming at all. You can see the difference, common kukri and Russell's kukri. Yeah, so keelbacks. In Bangalore, there are three kinds of keelbacks we found. There is two photographs we mentioned. So one is buff-striped keelback, and second is checkered keelback. There is one more species called olive keelback. So that's completely olive in color. So when you see the buff-striped keelbacks, they are not a pretty common spotting every time throughout the year. During the breeding time, they do come out. They are very small snakes, like hardly like 1.5 feet approximately. And they have a beautiful patterns and over long stripes in the upper part of the body. And there is a myth, very common myth about buff striped keelbacks. People do see, like they have a thought. So if you see, kill one snake, you will get a 9 snake same day. It's not like that. Because of during the breeding season, only the snakes coming out. Because of some females are available, they'll produce the hormones to attract the males. So more than one or two males will try to reach the space. So that time we spot the snake, that time people might have killed any snakes. So again, they will see other snakes. They thought by mistakenly, because I killed the particular snakes, so it's taking a revenge. It is not. So buff stripe keelback and no snakes takes the revenge. And checkered keelback. Checkered keelback also can called as water snakes. They will found in near water body and the water body. And the diet of the checkered keelbacks mostly consuming the fish, aquatic animals like frogs and toads. And they do lay eggs around 12 eggs approximately.
Request all participants to kindly mute yourselves.
Okay, thank you, Sneha. So far, we saw few of non-venomous species. Now we're going to see venomous species, which is very, very important. Requesting all participants, please be alert, because these are the very important session we're going to take it. Yeah. So there are four major venomous snakes found in Bangalore. So those four venomous snakes called as a big four venomous snake. Reason behind. These four venomous snakes causing more death in India, and also these four species found throughout the India. So in 2008, WHO made snake bite as a negligible disease. In that, they came up with a list of the over countries. In that, sad to say, India is one of the biggest threatening things, because people be not aware snake bite is a work hazard disease, and it's also negligible disease as well. So we should understand what is the venomous snake, what is non-venomous snakes, and we need to understand which is the right and which is wrong, first aid and treatment as well. Let's start with one of the unique and beautiful species, spectacle cobra. So spectacle cobra name, if you see the picture, you can see the second picture, you can see the markings. It's a spectacle. Spectacle means nothing but eye, the specs. So because of the mark, it's called as a spectacle cobra. Spectacle cobra is a very, very common and very well-known snake as well, because the people do worship the spectacle cobra. and they have a habit of active in daytimes, especially during the evening times. And also they do lay eggs about almost 18 numbers, 12 to 18 numbers. And they do incubate as well. And major diet of the cobras, like a small rodents, a small species of a lizard, also cobra have a character of cannibal. So they do eat other snake as well. And this month is one of the season for the cobra hatchlings. So upcoming days, you may get a chance of seeing babies cobra as well. Next. Yeah, common krite. So common krite, strictly nocturnal animal, which found only in nighttime. So it's very difficult to found until unless the place was disturbed. So if you see the identifying the common krite, the common krite is completely black in color. You can see the stripes, very linear stripes, white color stripes, just away from the neck, you can see the stripes. And common krite are also cannibal. They do eat other snakes as well. And they do lay eggs around 12 numbers. They found in leaf litters, termit mounds, even a pile of rocks and boulders. Next. Russell's viper. So Russell's viper, one of the little aggressive snake compared to common krite, Indian cobra. So it doesn't mean krite and cobras are more not aggressive, but they do aggressive. But Russell's viper, they do show the aggressiveness more. When they feel threatening, Russell's viper make a lot hissing sound. So you can know, right, like a cooker, pressure cooker. So it's like that. That will produce more, and they will enlarge the body. They pump the air in the whole elongated lungs and make
sir,
it bigger.
Sir, one question.
Hi, Deep. Could you please wait until the end of the session? We'll take in all questions. So please kindly wait till the end of the session.
Okay, madam.
Thank you. So that is one of the major defense mechanism, and also easy to identify the Russell's viper, because people do get a misunderstanding between Russell's viper, common sand boa, as well as Indian rock python. So Russell's viper, completely, you can see they have a diamond shape of head, and they have a diamond shape of like markings throughout the body. When you see the common sand boa or else Indian rock python, the pattern is completely different. And Russell's viper, they have a capacity of giving a birth. They don't lay eggs, they do give a birth. And they can give a birth around 30 to 40 babies. And this is again like a cobra. Russell's viper also now has a breeding season, like a giving birth season. You can also see a lot of babies in the future as well. And this is a Russell's viper have a little bigger fangs than other three snakes. Yeah, so a last of our big four venomous snake, saw-scaled viper. Reason behind the saw-scaled viper, this guys, when they feel threatening, they will coil their body and they'll rub the scales together, and that will produce saw sound. So you might have seen that the saw mill, how the machine is giving that, like that similar kind of the sound it will give by the helping of rubbing the scales. And they are very tiny snake, hardly 12 inches. And that are very deadly. Even though they are small, they are deadly snakes. Usually this kind of a species found in scrub jungle areas, grasslands kind of things. And they do also give a birth, not a laying eggs. And they give a young ones around 2 to 6 babies. And again, they are both and the saw scales vipers are ambush predators. They do stay in a place and wait the prey to come and attack, and they do consume. When other snakes like a spectacle cobra and a common krite, they do search for the prey. Next.
Thank you, Karthik.
Thank you, sir.
We'll talk about the type of venoms the snakes have. So it's, as the slide is very clear, there are two types, major type, neurotoxic and hemotoxic. And the neurotoxic, What happens when it is injected in somebody's body? They disrupt the nerve impulses which are being transmitted. So this will lead to complete neuromuscular paralysis. So then the descending paralysis occurs, then the respiratory failure occurs, and the cardiac failure occurs, and there'll be eventually death due to multi-organ failure. So this type of neurotoxic venom is usually seen in cobra and crate. And the hemotoxic, this is usually seen in the vipers. So what does this do? So it damages the whole circulatory system. The whole circulatory system goes for a sex. There'll be muscle necrosis, and eventually it starts off with, leads to kidney failure. So that's why wherever anti-snake treatment in hospitals, the three things are mandatory when you go look for a anti-snake venom treat and bite treatment. The first is the hospital should have ample quantities of anti-snake venom. Next, it should have a ventilator if you have a respiratory failure, and then you should have hemodialysis, which if you have a kidney failure. So in all the hospitals, these three things are mandatory. So snake bite cases in India, as you know, you must have seen all these statistics. So approximately 50,000 snake bites that occur annually in India. So many of them are not recorded. So like in the villages, there are a lot of myths. So they go into quacks and all, they die and they're not recorded. So actually the figures must be much more. So basically it occurs in the rural population. So especially the workers who are working in the field. So it's like the WHO says, this is a work hazard disease. So people working out in the field or going out in the dark in the villages without proper precautions, mostly it affects them. The bites occur with them. So we'll tell you, I'll add to what Karthik has said about their behavior. So there are some very interesting facts and peculiar facts. So all the snakes are ectothermic. So what does the word ectothermic mean? So the snake's internal physiological sources of heat are relatively of negligible importance. So actually they're not much there. So the internal physiological source of heat are relatively of negligible importance in controlling the body temperature, unlike the human beings. So such organisms and animals rely on the environmental source from the environment for the body heat source. And then they don't have eyelids. The snakes have no eyelids. And there's no external ear. So these are another two important things. And the senses, sight is good, but it's not very great. Hearing is poor. And they are sensitive to vibrations from the ground. So how does the movement takes place? So there are four different movements of the snakes. One they call the concentrina. So it's like the pull and the push train. The second is the lateral undulation, which is quite common in the snakes usually seen. So how they move laterally, undulating. And the third is the side winding. So this is usually seen in the very hot, the dry, the arid areas, the deserts. So one good example is the desert adder. So to beat the heat, the minimum amount of the body comes in contact with the ground surface. So that's how they do this side winding. And the next is the caterpillar type. So these are the four types they usually do. And coming to the feeding of the snakes, like Karthika said, they're primarily predators. So they predate. And how do they do this? They basically hunt by stealth and ambush. So that's the way they do. And how do the non-venomous snake, how do they kill their prey? So the non-venomous snakes usually crush. And by crush and constriction, they kill their prey. And the venomous, so as you know, they inject the toxin. So we'll be coming in detail afterwards how the fang marks look and all. So what does the venom usually contain? So the venom contains a cocktail of protein, toxins, and digestive enzyme. So the usually it is to paralyze the prey, kill the prey, and they also inject the digestive enzyme so that the digestion, I mean, after it is dead, the ingestion and the digestion is easy. So snakes never bite. So snakes swallow their prey as a whole. You must have noticed many a times. So Karthik was telling you about the breeding habits. So the breeding, approximately 25% of the snakes are ovoviviparous. That is, the eggs develop internally and they hatch internally and the female gives birth to young ones. So this occurs in about 25% of the snakes. So here the gestation period is around 30 to 50 days. The common example of this ovoviviparous is the boas and the rattlesnakes. And the next most common type is the oviparous or the egg layers. So rest of the 75% of this, the common examples being the rat snake, the cobra, the crate, etc. So the hatching period is around 60 to 70 days. So there's one peculiar aspect of hatching in snakes, which is not found in any other species. That is, when neonates are developing inside the egg, they use their heartbeats to communicate with each other. This is really amazing. So they use their heartbeats to communicate with each other and synchronize their metabolism. Not only they synchronize the metabolism and their hatching time, which means in a clutch of eggs laid, all eggs will hatch at approximately the same time. This is amazing. So almost within 36 to 48 hours. So I mean, within 2 days, all of them will hatch. So this is one very peculiar aspect of the snakes. And then coming to the sense organs. So they have the forked tongue, you see. So you must have seen jutting out and inside of the mouth. So this forked tongue take the chemical signal from the environment, what's happening, and they transmit through the Jacobson's organ to the brain. All this is present in the upper palate. So the brain decipherizes what is happening in the environment. And the python has a thermal sensing pit. So this is also very peculiar to the pythons. It is just present below the eye and above the nostril. So what does it do? This enables them to sense warm-blooded prey even in complete darkness. So acts as almost like a night vision device for them. Yes, Neha? So coming to who's affected and when, how? So the statistics say, so most of them affected are the farmers or the manual workers. So working without protection in the field or anywhere else. And most of the genders are male, mostly. So maybe the reason being the ladies or the females working in the field have a sari which covers them. So this might be one of the reasons of people working in the field where the male are more affected. So average age has been seen mostly around, the statistics say, around 15 to 29 years. Yes, ma'am. So when does it bite? So this is very interesting and deep research topic. So they basically in self-defense. So whether either they are stepped upon or their life is in danger. So what happens if your life is in danger? What will you do? So will you go and embrace the enemy and say, okay, friend, come and kill me. So what do? You scoot. Either you fight or you scoot. So the snake, why does it bite? So it's a, such a sensitive, such a helpless reptile. I mean, it can hardly move, you know, how slowly it moves. He can't see properly. He can't hear properly. So what other defense tool does he have except bite? So he'll bite only if his life is in danger. And you come to know about a snake. How does a snake come to know about human beings? So he can't see much. He can't hear much. How does he come to know? By the ground vibrations. So we tell people, so whenever they see a snake, so stand still, don't move. If you move, you can talk, gesticulate, whatever you do, the snake will not come to know unless you're very near and making sudden movements. Otherwise, don't move. So the ground vibration goes to the snake and the snake goes into panic, like the spectacle cobra. When he's in panic, he removes his hood. So when he removes his hood, there are a lot of hormones, flight hormones, stress hormones are being released. He cannot move. He just move around. You see, you must have seen a spectacle cobra moving around with his hood up. For him to move, he has to come back and get his hood down. So you have to see a snake. Just will tell you more about what to do when you see a snake. Just stand still. Give him about 5 minutes to escape. So he is very scared of human beings. There's no way he wants to bite you or have a fight with you. He is very scared for his life. So he will just move away. If you just stand still for about 5 to maximum 10 minutes and give him an escape route, he will move away. Yes, Neha?
Yes. Just one. Just one moment, sir.
Yeah, doesn't matter. Please go ahead. So doesn't matter. Let me say we'll go about the snake bite patterns. So there are two type of snake bite patterns. So you can differentiate clearly by the bite, whether it's a venomous snake or non-venomous snake. So if you find two definite fang marks, either in the hand or the leg or anywhere, so only the venomous snakes have fangs. So when they dig in their fangs, so you'll find two definite fang marks when it is a venomous snake bite.
Am I clear?
Yeah.
Fang.
Yeah, so these are the venomous snake bites. So you will find two clear marks or the fangs. So we'll show you compared to this, the non-venomous ones. So how does a non-venomous bite or whatever looks like? Now, this is a snake pattern of a non-venomous snake. So why is this like this? Because there are no fangs here. They're only teeth. So you will get teeth marks. So plenty of them. Like small pinpricks. So in fangs, the fangs are very clear. So it's a very controversial, will come afterwards about dry venomous bites and poisonous venomous bites. So this is the how you make out whether it's a venomous snake or non-venomous snake. Now we come to the mitigation. So it's the famous, they say 3 D's. So to mitigate, to prevent snakes coming to you or snake bites, the 3 D's here. The first is deny entry. So the snake is not coming into your house anywhere. So there's no chance of it biting you. Deny food. Deny shelter. Now, how do you put this deny entry? So you should, when the entrance should be, a house entrance should be at a height. And this pipe like this, you should have grill everywhere so that the water can come out, but nobody, no insects or snakes or anything can go inside. So deny entry. and then deny food. So here, no garbage, especially the kitchen waste. So should be disposed of properly. So this is the, we get many calls from apartments and many places telling, sir, okay, the snakes are coming to our house, anything. So this basically is because the garbage disposal is not proper. And to eat this garbage, all this, the rats come. And to eat the rats, the snakes come. It's a simple mechanism. So if you dispose your garbage properly and it is covered, not thrown out, and proper segregation and happens, you will control the rodents. The rodents are the main one which attract the snakes. So if you control the rodents, you're controlling the snakes. And then how do you deny shelter? Don't have a clutter. So anyway, clutter, the snakes can hide. So you're storing anything in your storeroom or something, store them at a height so that the snakes don't have place to hide. So where, if you find any sound or something, you can just peep down and see the base is clear. So store them at a height and don't have clutter. So where the clutter is there, they tend to come and hide. So these are the famous 3 D's which you should follow. Now, what do you do when you spot a snake? So these questions have been asked to us many a times. So we say, if you're near a snake, just move out. Do move away slowly. So don't do sudden movements. So when you do a sudden movement, if you're near a snake, he thinks you're coming to attack him and he'll bite. So move away slowly while keeping an eye on his head. So the head is the most important part. The fangs are there. So just move out slowly. Keep an eye on the snake and move away. And do not attempt to interact or take photos or videos. You've seen many heroes everywhere, people mistaking a Russell Viper as a python and says a non-poisonous snake, going near it, and the stories go on. The history says many of them have died. So don't become a hero. Don't attempt to interact or take photos or videos. So immediately somebody should contact a rescuer as soon as possible so that we come, the rescuer comes, we try to identify the snake, or we try to remove the snake and relocate the snake out of that place. And keep an eye on the snake. So if you're looking here and there, suddenly he might be hiding there itself. He'll just move away. So just keep an eye. So like I said before, don't move, don't make sudden movements, keep an eye. And keep, if he has no place to escape, just stand there till the rescuer comes. If there is a place for him to go, allow him to go away. He'll move away. So these are the certain personal safety habits you should follow. So don't touch, like I said, number one. Stay alert. Just keep watching him. What is he doing? Where is he going? So I hope he's not coming inside your house or somewhere. Just keep alert. And when you go out in the night anywhere, check before you step. So take a stick. So if there's a bush or something, a clutter, just use the stick to tap on the ground. Like I said, the vibrations alert the snakes. So if he's there, he'll make some movement, he'll move away, or there'll be, if he's hiding there or something. So check before you step. So keep the stick in front of you and move that and move around. Use a light in the dark. So that really helps, especially in the rural areas. We'll try, you can make out this sudden movement or what. So use the light. And sleep off the ground. This basically happens in villages. So you should sleep off the ground to prevent the snakes coming in, and use a mosquito net. And the mosquito nets should be properly tucked in. So this specially is quite common in villages where people die of crate bites. So what do you call here? Sweet death. So the crate has bitten and the death has been so fast and the person has died in the sleep. You don't know. The morning you find him dead. It doesn't even make a sound. So sweet death. So there are instances in the villages, what I just read recently, a couple of years ago, they had a mosquito net, they were sleeping in the ground, there was a hole in the mosquito net, a snake went in the family, husband, wife and daughter, all three found dead. Unfortunately, the snake could not escape out, so that's how they came to know it was a crate. He was still in the mosquito net. So he came in, he couldn't find out to go out, so all the three had died. So this is called, so you should have no access to the snakes. You usually sleep at a height and have the mosquito net. And use foot fear. This really helps to prevent snakes, I mean snake bites. Now some tips in snake bite management. So don't waste time. So thinking what is it, kya hua, what happened, which snake is this, something. So don't waste time to calling somebody, or getting a quack or something. So don't tie anything near the bite area. So the old analogy of tourniquet and all has gone. So many people who have put a tourniquet to stop the blood flow. So they had to amputate the limbs, the hand and the legs, because the toxin was so high, it led to the necrosis and gangrene of the hand and leg. So don't tie anything tight near the bite area. So if there's anything tight, rings, something, please remove them. Don't eat anything or drink anything. Don't touch or apply anything to the bite area. There's another myth. Somebody says sucking it out, all it says, this is all, I mean, no scientific analogy at all. So don't touch. Don't move or bend. So if you move or bend that area, the circulation is faster and the toxin may go up faster to the brain. So don't move or bend. And don't panic. This is the most important thing. So if you have a hospital, you can 100% be treated to and attended to. So don't panic at any instance. Yes, ma'am. Stay calm and move away from snake and call for help and ask for a stretcher. Now don't be a, many people try to be a hero. I'll go to the hospital. I'll go by himself. I ride my two-wheeler, four-wheeler. That's the most foolish thing to do, because if the action is immediate, you may faint on your wheel when you're driving. So ask for help. Somebody has to be there. So if you don't have help, an ambulance, even a bike or a scooter with three people, one riding, the person bitten in the middle and one sitting in the back, so it doesn't follow. You should move immediately to the nearest hospital. So call for help. So lie down and remove tight objects and clothing. Immobilize the bite area. Transfer the patient to a hospital that treats snake bites. And if possible, if you see the snake, you can take a photograph or something to tell the doctor what type of a snake it is, or help, or don't, but don't waste time on this. Okay, so you can easily make out if it's a venomous snake, the venom has been injected, there'll be immediately swelling, blistering, local necrosis, there'll be conjunctivitis and all that stuff happening, which will not happen if it is a non-venomous snake. So it's like just a pinprick, that's all. There'll be no inflammation in the area. So you might die due to shock, but otherwise not due to venom. So we have listed out the hospitals that treat snakes bites in Bangalore. So this is the list. So what does the, as soon as you go, what does the doctor do? So like I said before, you should have anti-snake venom. So anti-snake venom in a normal venomous snake bite, so the doctor may use up to 18 to 30 vials to treat one patient. So like I said, you should have a ventilator. The hospital should have a provision of ventilator, oxygen, and hemodialysis. So what the doctor does is he carries out this whole blood clotting test, what is famously known as WBCT. So that's to test the coagulation of the blood. So you'll collect about 4 to 5 ml of the blood and leave it standing for about 15 to 20 minutes. So if there's a solid clot form, so that means your coagulation capacity is good. That is grade 0. So there's no venom in your blood. So that's called normal coagulation. If the clot breaks when it tilts after this. So there are different grades in this, grade 1, 2, 3. So depending upon the neurotoxic or hemotoxic, what snake, so the grading is done. So, and they will actually treat, the doctor will take a call accordingly. So he'll treat you, like I said, with the, what is the, in India, what we use, what is made by the Serum Institute of India is the polyvalent snake, anti-snake venom. So what does it contain? It contains the cobra venom, the crate venom, the Russell vipers venom, and the soft-scaled viper venom. So all this is injected into a horse in different small quantity. So thereby where the antibody response in a horse is very robust. So at a very short period, you get high burst of antibodies, which is collected through serum and refined, and the anti-snake venom is made. So statistics shows that the bite marks, if you take that as 100 bite marks, 63% are in the lower limbs and 33% in the upper limb, and around 3 to 4% only in the head and the neck area. Next slide, Sneha.
Thank you so much, sir.
Yeah.
So friends, so far what sir told, that's very, very, very important, because so far only those kind of information and awareness materials helping to save a lot of people. And this education material not preferred day one. This education material was developed by Madras Crocodile Bank and Into the World company with a research of 2 years. So this informations are very effective. And please do educate the friends and the others to keep the snake bite away. So now let's see about myths about the snakes. So if you see, snake do not drink milk. So a lot of cases you might have seen, a lot of people are going and pouring the milk in the hermit mounds in the temples and all. That absolutely wrong practices. Reason behind, snakes are reptiles. So they can't digest any lactose content things, especially the milk. So snakes can't drink a milk. That's a completely wrong. Second, snake do not take revenge. As I mentioned before, people do say snakes will take revenge after 12 years, whatever it is, but snakes have very, very lesser memory things. They can't remember anything and they don't take a revenge. So whatever the people say taking revenge, that's completely again wrong. Snake can't hear. Yeah. So as sir mentioned, snakes doesn't have any external ears. They can't hear any sounds at all. They can able to sense only either vibration or short sightedness or the flipping the tongues to absorb the chemical molecule which is available in the air. Last, not all snakes are venomous. Exactly. So in India, around like a 200 plus snakes, only 20 species of snakes are venomous. In Bangalore, especially in the Bangalore part, we have only 4 venomous snakes. Rest are non-venomous. So when you encounter the snakes, please consider non-venomous snakes as a venomous snakes. Keep stay away from the snakes. That will help both snakes and humans. Snake venom used in many treatments, including like a snake antivenom serum was preparing by the snake venoms. And also there is a lot more research happening with the usage of snake venom to treat other remarkable diseases. Snake friends, next slide. Yeah, so again, snake drink milk. You know the answer. Snake can't drink milk at all. Snake dance to snake snammer's tones. Yeah. So as you mentioned before, snakes can't hear. But how? Snakes do move the head when the snake shams do the punky. So when you observe the snake shams, they do not only do the play the music. When playing the music, they do shake the whole body. So eventually the cobras, which have a okay eyesight, they will see that the image So they're trying to defense, like when they're rising the hood, they try to follow the image. So it's look like a dance, but it's they can't hear the voice. They can't, they won't dance. They're just following the threatens. Yeah. So again, snake can't take a revenge. Yeah. So this is very, 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 very common things. So people do have a myth. The snakes give a very precious stones kind of thing. And also they do say if the snakes are not using their venom for 10 years, 12 years, the venom become a precious stones. It's not a right. Reason behind all venomous snakes need to use their venom to catch their prey. If the venom not able to used so far, the snake can't survive. So whatever the people think, that is completely wrong. There is no any precious stones coming from the snake. Do snakes spit venom? So far that. Hello. Yeah. So far there is no any spitting species available in India. But very recent days, they are coming with the small researchers and they got a couple of records, especially North said monarchal cobra, they increasing their ability and like started spitting the venom. There is a new research going on that. But apart from that, no snakes spit the venom. Next.
Thank you, Karthik. So the basically about the snake presentation is over. We'll be taking questions now. I mean, after this a couple of slides, we'll just tell you in brief, within 3 to 4 slides, what does PFA do? The PFA Wildlife Hospital, the PFA Conservation Center. So here we'll be telling you about the two unique things we do in other than rescuing animals 24 hours, treating them. We treat very complicated surgeries. We put intramedullary pins into the legs of monkeys, macaques, and into the wings of black-eyed birds, and rehabilitating them and releasing them. We do two unique things, which no other conservation center does in the country or in the world. The first is the acupuncture in snakes. So due to unplanned urbanization in Bangalore and the indiscriminate use of JCBs to clear the dwelling places of snakes, we get huge cases of snakes with spinal fracture. So this takes us a long time to rehabilitate and recover the snake. So first we have to find out the fracture site in the spine. We have to immobilize and bring about healing of that fracture site of the spine. And then unfortunately, the body below the fracture site gets paralyzed due to nerve damage. So it takes us a long period to rehabilitate them. It almost takes us about 3 to 4 months to get the sensation back by different methods of physiotherapy. So what we are doing now is we are using the advanced physio laser for recovery combined with acupuncture in snake. Now acupuncture technique in snake is not being done anywhere in the world as for the snakes. So what the basic idea of acupuncture, if you know, it is through the use of extremely fine needles. We manipulate the flow of G in the body. So G, if you somebody knows about acupuncture, is a life force or the energy force. So we do this. So what we are doing is using the latest modern physio laser with the traditional veterinary medicine of acupuncture. So we are combining them both and bringing about healing in this snakes. So this has been hugely successful with us. So previously we used to take a long time. Now almost about 20 to 25% of the rehabilitation time is cut by a combination of both the methods we use this. So we are specialized in treatment of snakes here. So we teach them, we had a seminar recently, about a year ago, to the SARC veterinarians. We invited veterinarians from Bhutan, Nepal, Sri Lanka, and Bangladesh. So, and many of them from Bangladesh came. So we had a good seminar. We where we exchange our ideas, the technology we have and the expertise we have. So this is me taking a class and explaining to the veterinarians from all over the country and Bangladesh. We exchange our expertise and they learned a lot, especially the veterinarians from Bangladesh. So this is one technique which we do. The next technique which is unique to us is the implantation of feathers. Now, what do we call famous as the imping? The imping or the implantation is a method of repairing broken or damaged feathers. A feather replacement is done by joining a donor feather to the shaft of a broken feather using a dowel and a glue. The repaired feather will subsequently mold out as normal and new feathers will grow to replace it. So what we basically do is we have a feather bank of feathers of all different birds which are with us, or also we exchange feathers from other conservation centers. So this is a unique technique where you can, a bird which has lost its feathers, which is quite common in Bangalore, especially due to this manja, use of indiscriminate use of Chinese manja, these black kites, owls, the barbets getting stuck into them and they start fluttering. It's a nylon manja, it does not break. So it causes huge, not only fractures to them, many a time the feathers are lost or broken. So what we do is implant this feathers from the donors by using high density glue, and almost overnight we make the bird rehabilitate and it is able to fly back. So which otherwise would have taken a couple of months. So we have to would have to keep them in a cage or in a shelter where the wildlife instincts for the bird is gone. We almost overnight the bird is able to fly. So this is another technique which we intensively practice at PFA.
So thank you, Colonel Nawaz and Karthik. So just to quickly brief you all about what PFA does. PFA is the city's oldest wildlife hospital. We have been here for the last 25 years. And PFA also works on a model of 4 R's that we call. The first one is of rescue. We get calls from various people across the city who tell us about any orphaned, injured, or displaced wildlife. And we have a team of rescuers that rescue them. Followed by this, we have a team of veterinarians that treat these animals. And the third R is rehabilitation. So we have rescued over 200 species, and rehabilitation for each species is very unique. And also the condition that they have come in with also dictates what kind of rehabilitation we have to give. So that's our third R. And the fourth R, which is our happiest step, what we call is the release, being able to put back the animals back into their natural habitats, their homes. This is when it's also like a moment of success for us. So far we've rescued nearly 28,000 wildlife across, 203 species. And, all of you might wonder, how is it that you can involve yourselves? How is it that you can help? What you can do is you can become a volunteer. PFA has a very good volunteer program that you can enroll for. All our details of volunteering, or even internships, it's all available on our website, link to which we will share in the upcoming slides. The next thing you can do is adopt an animal. So of course, when you say adopt an animal, this is a passive adoption program where you sponsor for the care and treatment of the animals that we are presently treating. And it's also because it's illegal to have wildlife as pets. This is an option that we give so people can do their bit. Another thing that you can do is you can help us set awareness programs. So we conduct various workshops. Apart from the snake workshop, which is a very popular one among us, the most widely conducted one is called as Living with the Wild, where we educate people on how to coexist with the wildlife of the city, given that there are so many species and that their contribution is endless. So you can also get in touch with us and set up awareness programs for your community. you can also donate for you know, the feeding and medical care of our wildlife. And most importantly, we request you to be a hero. Be a hero by saving an animal in need. If you spot an injured wildlife, please do call our free rescue helpline, which I will just share in the upcoming slides. Then we also request you to follow us on social media. We post content actively and update you all on the various things that goes on at our hospital. So, and also we request all the participants to kindly share your email IDs in the chat section. If you wish to not share it publicly in the chat section, you can also DM us, just send us a message on any of our social handles, and we will share with you interesting newsletters month on month. And we can also answer any query that you may have. And here is our wildlife rescue numbers. We will, you can visit us at pfawildlifehospital.org or call us on these numbers. And now we are ready to take in any questions that you may have. One is you can either drop them in the comment section, or you can also ask, you can please unmute yourselves now, and but request you to do one by one. Our chief veterinarian and Karthik, both of them will answer your questions.
Ma'am, I have a question.
Sure.
Okay, ma'am, I actually want to tell a few things, and I also have a question.
Yeah, please.
Ma'am, the first question is, when a venomous snakes bite you, are you supposed to take a cloth and cover it so the venom does not reach the other parts of the body?
Yeah, so actually that is a wrong practice which following so far. Hello?
Yes.
Yeah, so that is a wrong practice which is following, but the right thing, no disturbing the site area. If the site area have any construct objects like a rings, watch, bangle or anything, should be removed. Reason behind, if it was a venomous snake bite, so after a couple of minutes, the venom going to react. If the venom started reacting, that site area, bitten area going to be swollen. Okay. So if any kind of a constricting object was there, that's going to stop blood flow. So that leads to very big problem. So suggesting no putting any kind of tight objects and removing the whatever the tight objects. And putting a cloth and putting a tourniquet is also not advisable. That's a wrong practice.
Okay. And then after that, in front of my house, I saw a rat snake.
Okay.
And can rat snakes climb trees?
Yeah, the rat snakes are very good climbers. They do climb the trees.
Okay.
Yeah, I have a question.
Yes, please.
I want to know the brief difference between ovoviviparous, viviparous, and the other one is oviparous.
So oviparous, the word only derives O. Egg shape, egg. So it's a very common in the snakes, like they have both the characteristics. They can lay eggs, they can also give a birth. So the oviparous snakes, which we lay eggs, is like a complete cladiac shell, like a hard shell kind of thing. They do lay eggs. But when it's coming to oviviparous, they have a egg sac membrane inside the body. The embryo will grow inside the womb, and before the time of giving birth, the thin leathery membrane, it will completely break inside the body, and only the babies do come out.
So let me add here. So like Karthik said, so oviparous is they develop internally and the female gives birth. So in viviparous, there are no eggs at all. In oviparous, eggs are there inside the female and they develop. So in viviparous, like the human being, there's no eggs at all. So live birth is being given. This occurs in anacondas. And then the other is oviparous, where the eggs are laid and they hatch outside the body. So oviparous, eggs are there inside the body, hatch, and the live one comes out. Viviparous, the live one comes out directly. Oviparous, the eggs are laid outside, they hatch outside.
Yes, sir. And one more question I have. Do we have poisonous snakes?
No. Actually, there is one research happening because as you like in so far they have a record of venom. So there is no record of a poison snake. But very recently there is a one research happening on red-necked keelback. So that particular species snakes also have a venom. That research is happening, but it's still in the research process. But apart from the rest, all snakes have only venom.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, I have a question.
Yes, ma'am, please.
So like the people now, like what I found out is like relocating the snakes very far.
Yeah.
Like more than 2 kilometers or 3 kilometers of radius.
Yeah.
Can lead to the, you know, the, what do you say, the border wars of the snakes.
Yeah.
And then you just die and all.
Yeah, yeah. That's 100%, ma'am. Because see, when in our slide, we mentioned relocate. Relocate, it means it's not like a so far. As per protocol, we do follow relocation around like a less than 1 or 2 kilometers, which is like where have enough green part where they can survive. Reason behind that particular species snake where we rescued, that only that place are very familiar. So that snake know where to find a food, where to find a water, and where shelter can be. If we releasing a relocate very far or little far, so they can't find the water and food and shelter and when they need one. Second thing, and also they, if that particular snake have any disease, that is have a chance of spread there also. And also such things to study, there is a telemetry projects happening in India to understand the possibilities of relocation successful. But as per things, no suggestion of relocating snakes very far. If the snake were rescued in a house, inside the house, it should be released as much closer in the greenery parts.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am.
I want to continue with this question. Do snakes have a territorial areas like how dogs and other animals have?
They are kind of solitary animals. But when it comes to vipers, they are ambush predators. The territory is not so big. But if it was other species like cobras, they have a wide range of roaming. If when roaming, if they're able to encounter the snake, yeah, obviously the conflict is going to be there.
Can I ask a question, please?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Is there any handy snake repellent available if I'm traveling somewhere? Or,
no, ma'am.
You know, can DO spray or Odomos repel them if I spray it on my body? Will it repel them? Anything handy available?
No, yeah, no, ma'am.
Yeah, Karthik, let me. Yeah, strong smell. Unfortunately, you said you're going to spray this on yourself, not on the snake. If you go to spray on the snake is gone. The eyes will go. So strong, pungent smell do repel snakes. The research says. I mean, they won't come near strong and pungent smells. So this keeps the snakes away.
Mm-hmm. So we can use DO or
on yourself. We can use a variety of them.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah,
thank you.
Are the essential oils effective?
Essential oils don't have such a strong aroma as the other this one has. So it needs a strong aroma. You see the like I said, the fork tongue has to get the chemical. The sprays and all have strong chemicals. So the fork tongue has to hit some chemical particles and then it goes to the Jacobson gland and they decipher there's a strong smell. So I don't think those oils you're mentioning have strong aroma.
Yeah, an extension to that question, sir, like basically if you're going for any farm visit or field visit along with the kids, how do we protect? What kind of measures we can take?
Yeah, that's a good question. Best is to stay alert and give the children a stick with them and have the legs covered. So if you can have shoes up to the ankle and a bit above, that is the best thing you can have. So, and tell them if they're going into any bush or something, to use the stick on the ground and just use it on the bush to clear it. Like they say, they're very sensitive animals. So if the ground vibration coming itself, will move them away. So you're moving in the night, like I told you, all the precautions. So use a light and be alert. So just using a stick and tapping them on the ground, that itself is enough for you.
Which are near our area?
beg your pardon?
Sir, can we donate feathers which are lying on the ground?
You're welcome to come and give it to us. We'll keep it in the bank, feather bank, and use them. You're welcome to do that.
Yeah, I have an exemption. So I want to clear it.
You can donzo them to us if you can't come. So it will be welcome. Not only you, others, which you found the natural feathers. So you can, these feathers can give life to so many birds overnight. We'll make them fly. Rather than being tied up in a cage for quite some time till the natural feathers come up, we'll put them back to wild immediately.
Hello?
Yes, hi.
I noticed that you guys are recording it. Like, we couldn't join initially because of limited seats. Like, can you share like where the recordings are?
Hi. Yes. We'll be uploading the recording of the whole workshop on Facebook and YouTube. So it'll be accessible. It'll be accessible whenever you wish to. It'll be uploaded in a couple of hours.
Thank you. I have a small assumption. I want to clear it up whether it's true or wrong.
Yes, please.
So as we communicate with the rest of the animals through our touch, I feel that the dancing snake part, which you were explaining us, some tell that even the taps on the ground, sometimes they do communicate with the snakes. Is it right?
No, actually, when they tap, it's like a trigger the snake, because it's a basic, snakes can sense the vibration, right? When they're tapping...
As we have types of touches with the animals, as they sense it, types of taps may also be sensed, right?
It's...
Nene, if you see the juggler, he does many tricks to attract, like you said, the music, they don't hear at all. He makes sudden movements and also keeps tapping his leg. If you see the snake juggler, the snake charmer, how he does. So he does a combination of both, sudden movement where the snakes... He goes near it, and most of the mouth has been the venomous fangs have been removed. Most of them, he knows that the snake is not going to bite him, so many of them sieve up their mouth, and he goes near it. He is in no danger, and he suddenly does body movements and also taps on the ground. So this both attracts the snake, and that's how the snake suddenly turns this side and that side. There's nothing to do with the music. Yes,
no communication will be established between them.
Beg your pardon?
No communication will be established between the snake and the charmer.
Yes.
No. He's just defending himself by the sudden movement and trying to see where the sound is coming. Vibration and the... Since he's so near, the eyes, they have limited vision, and this movement also is trying to defend itself from where... What is happening? So it is just to get the attention of the snake. Right side, left side. He keeps moving.
Okay, got it. And last year, I rescued a small kid snake, which was, I think the vertebral column was broken by some vehicle's wheel. I called the rescue team from PFA, and they reached around half an hour later. But I want to know, what are the precautionary measures that I can take to save its life? Because it was dead by the time they came.
So you can't do anything. The best thing is to... If it is a venomous snake, don't go near the snake. The snake is already injured, and he will be very agitated, and all his stress hormones must be pumping all over his body. So he's already injured. So there's no point, but still they have ability to bite. So there's no point in the person getting bitten more by it. So just stay away and keep a watch on the snake. Keep a watch on the snake and call us.
So nothing can be done before
nothing you can do. You're putting your life into danger. Please don't do anything. Just keep a watch on it and call us.
Thank you.
Can we use monovalent ASV if... Hello?
Pardon?
Can we use monovalent ASV if the exact species of snake were bitten, if you know?
So in India, there is no monovalent.
Yeah.
All they have is a polyvalent. That is a cool and like a happiest things we have in India. If you compare to other countries, they have a monovalent. Whatever snakes do, they were strike, they have to use exact same antivenom. But India, we have a polyvalent.
Because the basic reason is we don't know which snake has bitten, and the the feedback or the history from the people around or something, or the person who's in bitten itself is very sketchy, and most of the bites happen in the night, they don't know. So this is the reason the India, this polyvalent has been highly successful. So now there's a lot of research going on cell-based culture, anti-venom antibodies. So this is being used all over the countries abroad. So the research is going on in India in a couple of firms where this will be in smaller quantity and the action will be faster. Instead of using 18 to 30 vials in a bitten person, we'll be using lesser and the effect will be more. So the getting this cell culture anti-snake venom is, the work is on in India in a couple of firms.
Is there a way to ensure that snakes don't enter the houses, or like, I don't know how far it can climb and all, like, is there a way?
I think you should see the presentation. So we've gone through this. Please go through the presentation. It's loaded on the Facebook. We have gone in very detail about this.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Sir, I have a doubt.
Sir, normally up to what elevation can the snakes normally climb along the walls or high buildings?
Okay, so if it's again depends on the species, not all the snakes are good climbers, and if the wall or anything have enough grip to anchor themselves, they can climb even more. And also we had a calls of rescues, like where we rescued like a snake in the third or fourth floor also. Reason behind, they have a pipes, they take a trip on both sides, they are climbing. If any possibility, like anchoring themselves or a wall is so hard, any kind of normal, apart from vipers, most of the snakes do climb well. And especially the wolf snakes, they are very good climbers, even like rough walls.
Especially if you have overhanging branches onto your balcony or something, so they can easily drop down from the branches.
They can't climb smooth walls. They need any kind of harder anchor points to anchor themselves. So they can't, if there is no any anchor point, there is completely smooth wall, they can't climb. So they can able to, any snake, they can able to rise that three times of the body until unless they get any grip to move further.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Sir, one more thing. Are snakes under stress while molting their skin? It's said that you should not interrupt while they are molting the skin, or should keep the distance.
So actually, molting is the sign of their growth, because snakes can grow, but the snakes skin like a shedding can't grow. So whenever the snakes grow, they need to remove the sheddings. And again, it's again like a myth. Might be somebody told wrong, but basically it's not like that. But it's like a kind of, it's good to avoid the snakes.
I want to share the incident. Like one of my friend had got bitten by checkered chillback, and he had a infection on his bitten area and swollen kind of thing for a month or two. And I want to know, like, why
was he given anti-snake venom?
No, nothing.
Yeah, that is because the site where he got bitten was infected. So there must be something, some dirt or something, some bacteria. So when the non-venomous snake bites, there'll be puncture marks like pinpricks. So the infection must have gone. So basically, otherwise it is a non-venomous snake. It's a case of infection from the surface.
Okay, sir. Yeah. So if a non-venomous snake bites, there might be a problem of getting infection.
Yeah, there might be. You should wash the area and go to the doctor. After going to the doctor, and he will wash the area and give you a tetanus toxoid and put you on a course of antibiotics to prevent this, because it's almost like getting a, like I told you, you're taking a pin prick or something. So if there is an infection on the pin, if there's infection on your hand, by the prick it goes inside. So you need a course of antibiotics, and also to make sure it's a non-venomous, then take the treatment for the inflammation and whatever doctor will prescribe it to you. It's advisable to take an antibiotic course.
Okay, thank you so much.
I have a doubt, sir.
Thermal based vision. Sir, do all snakes have thermal based vision, or how do they see the things at night or the daytime? Do they see the colors like other mammals do?
No, they don't have a color vision. Actually, there is a two, even daytime, there is a couple of snakes, like a diurnal snakes are there, and nocturnal snakes are there. As you mentioned, thermal image, the snake which have a pit organ, especially like a vipers, and also like in even python have a pit organ. The snake which have a heat receptor organ, only such snakes can see the thermal images. Rest all can able to depend on their basic eyesight and again tongue flippings.
Yeah, if there are any more questions, we'll take.
Sir, I have doubt that every someone will say that the costliest pearl is present in the snake's mouth, which is known as Nagamani. And yeah, on the basis of this, many are doing the serials and the movie. This is true or fake?
It's wrong. It's wrong, ma'am. It's completely wrong. That's what we mentioned a little earlier. So that's completely wrong. So they, if you see the myth, they will say their venom should saved to become a Nagamani. But the venomous snake has to use every venom to get the prey. So it's a completely myth, ma'am.
It is, the venom is basically protein. So there's no chance of that solidifying and becoming anything. So the many myths associated with snakes, like this one, and like the special one, the movies and the Nagin and all, they show you that they will come and the next janam. So this guy is so helpless. He can't defend himself in this life. He doesn't know where to go, what to do. How will he come into this other life?
Huh.
I mean, he's so helpless, reptile. So there's no way and all that. These are all myths created, like eating milk, we explained. So any, they starve the snake for many days and he gets dehydrated and then they give the milk. He drinks up. So the milk will kill him because he's not digested at all. So this is all myths. All the milk come in. So due to religious, whatever, we pour so much of milk. India being such a poor country, so much of milk is being wasted. It goes nowhere. It goes to the ground. So there's so many myths associated with them.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, in case of...
Why, sir, horses are specifically used to, horses serum is used to extract out the anti-venom,
yeah,
while preparing the anti-venom.
Yeah, yeah, that's a good question. They are basically horses to many, they're physiologically are similar to human beings. So that is one. And the antibody response is very robust. So they immediately bring out huge quantities of antibodies. So the circulation, the blood quantity is being huge. So we can take quite an amount of serum and harvest, a large quantity of antibodies with them, from them, on which we filter that and use that as, make them as anti-serum. So that's why compared to all other animals, so and they being very sensitive, they immediately react to the smaller portion of the venom being injected into them. So there's an immediate response compared to other large animals of cattle and anything, where the response is very slow. So we get a harvest of antibodies immediately, very fast. So that's why horses are being used.
Sir, in case of cobra or great bite, can we use 20-minute whole blood clotting test?
Yeah, that is basically always done by all the doctors. So they will take you, put you on life supporting, looking at, so if the bite also, by the look at the bite itself, we can make out the fang marks, and then there'll be swelling, reddishness, the clinical symptoms. To sometimes many of the symptoms get aggravated by shock itself. So the person starts imagining, even though it might be a non-venomous snake, he may start imagining that it's a venomous snake and go into shock. So to rule out all these possibilities, he puts you on a monitor to monitor your heartbeat and everything. And also this test is done to know if the clot is very good, then you know it's a base, it's totally a non-venomous snake of the W, the whole blood clotting test. So if the clot is solid, grade zero, then it is amply clear to the doctor. This test has been used many years ago and still being used everywhere. Even though we have more advanced tests to find out the immunoassay test to find out about is a venomous snake, a non-venomous snake, still this test still holds good solidly. Thank you, everybody.
Sir, why is it said that after a boom slang's bite, it is followed by the bleeding from each and every orifices of the body? It's quite a strange thing.
Okay, pardon?
Sir, it's said that it is a strange thing that is said for the boom slang snake, that after its bite, it is followed by the bleeding from each and every opening of the body.
Yeah, so basically, boom slang is an African species. Okay, so apart from the neurotoxic and hemotoxic, certain species of venom also act as a myotoxic, even like a crit have that characteristic. So that basically liquidify the whole solid particle. So it will reduce the viscosity as well as it will reduce, it will start eating the muscle. It's making a completely fluidity. So during that venom reactions, all openings like a nose, ears, wherever the openings are, the fluid discharge will be happens.
Yeah, necrosis occurs, and also there will be severely hemotoxic. So even small vessels start busting. Not only because their dependent part, nostril and all come, it starts busting all over the body, internally also.
Okay, sir.
It makes the cellular membrane of the blood vessels very fragile. So it starts busting. Sneha?
Yes, sir. So do we have any other questions? We can also take whatever questions that you might have. Like I said, you can follow us on social media and message us. We are at PFA Wildlife Hospital on Instagram and PFA Wildlife Rescue and Conservation Center on Facebook. So please send us your messages and we'll ensure to answer all of them. So if there are no other pressing questions, we'll conclude the session for today. Thank you. We thank you all so much for participating. And like I mentioned, the session will be uploaded on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram later today. So you can use the recording to refer to any of the material that was discussed. And yes, please do stay in touch. Thank you, everyone.
I think Anjana has a question about memory of snakes on the chat box.
Yeah.
So yeah, there are quite a few questions we'll take in if.
So there are important questions we can address. So there's like I already said, he's such a helpless reptile. There's no memory. He can't defend himself in this life. So there's no question of all this memory. These are all myth. The filmmakers, everybody has made stories about them. But there is a catch to this also, because this was made by ancestors. Why did they make a story like this, that it has a memory, that it will come back? Because they knew what important role the snakes play in the ecological balance. Our ancestors knew that. So that to protect the snakes, so that they're not killed. That is the reason I think that these stories were made, that they'll come back to in next janam or so many janam, to protect them. The ancestors knew what is the importance of snakes many, many years ago. So protect their lives, they made myths and stories around them so that they don't get killed. Scientifically, this has no ground.
Excuse me, sir. Sir, I had a small query. I work for a press now, so I'll be traveling from India to Mysore every day. Okay, and once it so happened that there was a snake on which the tail was run, like a vehicle run on its tail, and only the tail part was damaged. Okay, and it was around 11:30 in the night. I was traveling back to Mysore, so I was trying to help it out, but I was at least trying to put it into the side with the help of a stick, and the villagers just came in and somebody smashed that to death. So how can such situations be controlled? Because that time I don't think any snake charms are available.
No, that's really very, very unfortunate. That is because people are not sensitized. So to what an important role the snake plays in the food chain, the villagers do not know. So how important ecological balance is, as it is due to their, not being sensitive. So best thing, many a time, as many injuries, they get healed by themselves in the snake. I've seen. We have got many snakes whose bones have been, the spine is a bit curved. So most probably it must have got injured somewhere, and nature seems to have done healing. So in these cases, if the injury is very less, you rightly did, we should have kept it on the side. And hopefully after the initial shock, if there are no rescuers available, it would have moved out. So So there was a chance it would survive rather than they being such senselessly killed. So each snake anybody is killing, so many rodents will increase. Like I said, it eats 300 rodents, and I said how they multiply so fast. So I mean, each snake you're killing, thousands of rodents will multiply. So they'll create more and more havoc. So people should be sensitized. So that is the reason we are holding all these seminars, and we are holding seminars at our center and these webinars to sensitize people. So we also have a very robust school ecology education system at PFA, where we pre-COVID, we have addressed almost 6 lakh students, and we have visited almost 6,000 schools. So we invite after the COVID situation stabilizes, or previous pre-COVID, we used to invite these schools to come to us. We used to make them into batches. We take them around our 6-acre conservation center, and we show them live feeding of animals, especially to the students. And we have detailed audiovisual presentation about how rescue is done, how the veterinarian trains, how rehabilitation is done. So many of the students, at the starting of the class, I asked them, do you find the snake as a friend or enemy? So many of them say about the enemy. Then we show them videos, okay, how it eats snakes, how it's a friend of the farmer, how it prevents zoonosis, how it helps in ecological balance. And at the end of the presentation, I asked them again, what do you think, is a friend or a enemy? So all the students say the snake is a friend. So this is the change we're looking for, especially in the students. So we feel the students are the ambassadors to save the future degradation of the environment, to save the environment. So we tell them the cages of plastic. I have removed an operation in cows, okay, how plastic plays havoc. How a straw was found in a sea turtle deep in the Indonesian ocean, and how it had respiratory distress. So we tell them not to use plastics, to argue the parents, they should take cloth bags, the students should save water, they should put off the light. So we teach them all this. So sensitization about the environment, about the wildlife, animals, plants is very important.
Sir, can these sessions also be conducted for the rural people? Because right now, it's the future thing is fine, but present will depend. Like future is dependent totally on the present controlling of the deaths of the snake. So,
yeah, we can. We are ready to. If somebody can get in touch with us, we have a controlled audience. People are there, or through webinars. So we are ready to extend our help. All and all of this is free of charge. So our main aim, like we are invested hugely in the child ecology education program. So all this is to sensitize the general public, and we are very happy. So we were planning to have this outreach program spread out in the villages a couple of years ago. We're looking for sponsors. We are totally a charitable organization, dependent on charity of animal. We are not supported by any government or by any organization. So we are saving the wildlife of Bangalore. We want Bangaloreans to come forward. So we were looking for sponsors who could sponsor a vehicle for us or something, so we can go out to the village outskirts and hold our outreach program. So we have covered major part of the city now, the schools and all. So we'd be happy to go out outskirts and village
Thank
and
you,
panchayats
sir.
And hold this. And you in the press, what's your good name? Hello?
Sir, Sampreeta.
Sampreeta, you should write about us, the work we are doing, and the sensitization.
Yes, sir.
With us, we will give you all the statistics, and putting in the local Kannada daily newspapers also will help to a large extent.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Any other questions? In the chat, we have one more question. How to identify the gender of snakes?
Yeah, Karthik.
Visually, it's very difficult to identify for a normal person because there is no any sexual dimorphisms are there.
So only a little experience and knowledge, and also the probing is the only technique we can able to identify the genders. So they are not we can't see visually and identify the male or females.
Okay, any other questions?
Hello sir, this webinar was very much helpful. Sir, I would like to know if there are any other programs on educating at the technical aspects of the snakes which are hosted by you or any other third party programs which you would recommend.
No, we are ready to hold any, we hold advanced snake sensitization program and snake workshops for veterinarians and rehabilitators for school children, not only on snakes, on different, a slide put out, we have saved 203 different species, almost 28,000 animals. Name of the black kites, what black kites are facing now by the Chinese manja, the hazards, the dangers. So we have different varieties of interactive webinars on environment, especially engaging with the school students. So we have held many webinars with the Shishu Graha, Gopal International Schools, and many other schools. We are happy to hold a variety of sensitization programs and environment on wildlife, urban wildlife, and other related matters. You can get in touch with us and we'll be happy to oblige.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
So there's another question. Do you have any courses or programs for veterinary students?
Yeah. So this is a good question. You can visit our website. We have a series of volunteer program and internship in veterinary. So we have veterinary students from Royal Veterinary College of London, from veterinary students from Austria, Nepal, veterinarians from Nepal, Bangladesh coming and interning with us. So we almost at a given time, we have around 150 to 200 animals undergoing different treatment and rehabilitation at our center of so many different species. So it's a hand-on practical experience. I mean, you can't get such kind of practical experience anywhere. So in the colleges, you all get only theory. Here, every day, it's only hand-on practical experience. So we welcome veterinary students. Please visit our website, apply for internship. We'll be happy to have you.
Also another question. How to identify the cobras except Caspian cobra because all of them look the same?
Yeah, Karthik, you can take this.
So each cobras have a different markings. Like if you see spectacle cobra, as I mentioned, they have a spectacle mark. If you see monocle cobra, they have a single round. So monocle cobra. So like that, every species have a different colorations, different scale patterns, and again, like a different this shape also. So due to that only we can able to make it. So it's completely like about the color and patterns.
Yeah, even the spectacle on a spectacle cobra, like the Gandhi spectacle, no two are similar. It is absolutely like the human fingerprint. So no two, there'll be different contours of this spectacle, the shape of the spectacle on the hood. So they say no two are similar. Yeah, I think we'll call it a day.
Sure. Thank you, Sneha, everyone.
Sneha, Karthik.
Sure. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Karthik. Thank you all.
Thank you, Sneha. Thank you, sir.
Sure.